Ecclesiastes, it's a painful, dark book, trying to climb life's highest peaks and just survive life's lowest valleys. Ecclesiastes is about purpose, a quest that millions find themselves on today. What's my purpose? Why am I here? Why does life feel this way? It was written by the man who had everything, who did everything, who knew as much as a human could possibly know. One of the richest men in history, king of one of the great countries of his time, married to over 700 women. Well, that last one's not so good. Solomon. Born through adultery and murder, his own half-brother tried to kill his dad. Solomon knew God and was given more wisdom than any before or after. He wrote three of the books of wisdom, Proverbs, this, and Song of Solomon. Those other two represent two of his peaks. This one, Ecclesiastes, represents the bottom of the bottom, the gutter of the gutter. He was the wisest, richest, and most famous person of his time, like Jeff Bezos mixed with Kanye mixed with Einstein. But he found out that it's all kind of just empty. Ecclesiastes is what happens when you find out that all you pursued wasn't worth it, that life for life's sake is empty, that money for money's sake is empty, that it's all just empty. The word he uses is vanity. He uses it a lot, 38 times in the book. It means vapor or breath or emptiness. But at the very bottom of these poems and speeches and ruminations on emptiness, there is a fullness from God, but we've got to wait to get there. Let's just examine the text together, all right? Most literature and art we're familiar with is linear. That means the story progresses forward with a clear beginning, middle, and an end. But a lot of ancient Middle Eastern literature, and that of Israel in particular, doesn't follow a linear path, but rather a cyclical path. Meaning the work circles around, highlighting similar concepts with new nuances as it progresses. Ecclesiastes is a cyclical book in that sense. The subject is purpose, the feeling is emptiness, the tone is dark. Here's a quick overview of the book. The first two chapters are vanity explained, then a few chapters of vanity explored, then a few of vanity expanded, and the last three is vanity exonerated. Here's how it opens. Vanity of vanities. All is vanity, Solomon says. All is emptiness. For chapters 1 and 2, the old king explains what he means, posing big questions. He starts with a poem about the cyclical nature of life, and then that poem becomes his style. His point, there's nothing new. Everything's recycled and forgotten. Solomon talks about having seen it all, enjoyed it all, and the emptiness that follows. The emptiness of pleasure, the emptiness of pursuit of wisdom, and the emptiness of work. Chapter 1:18 says, "For in much wisdom there's much vexation, and he who increases knowledge increases sorrow." Man, this is sad stuff. Chapters 3 through 6 are the examples of vanity. There's a beautiful poem about the times for everything in the world. Solomon talks about the immutability of God, the inevitability of death, the oppression and evil of man, the forgetting of strong leaders, laziness, business failures, working for money, only to not take it with you when you die. Then Solomon moves into the next section. Vanity expanded is what I've called it. This is chapters 7 to 9, and it contains language and format much more similar to the book of Proverbs. It's shorter, it's pithier, but it's the same content, but it's filtered through the style of the Proverbs. He talks about the difference between wisdom and folly. He talks about advice in dealing with kings, the rewards of fearing God, God's unknowability, and more on the inevitability of death. It's just sad, man. He gives an illustration of the chance of death. He's like, it could happen to anyone at any time. Then he talks about the chance of wealth. He says it doesn't always go to the smartest people. Then he tells a story. There was a city with only a few men living in it, and a king came and surrounded the city to capture it. So this king's got like a big army and all this stuff to siege the city. It's looking like everybody in it's gonna die. Then this poor wise man turns up with a plan and delivered the city. Okay, so this is a pretty good story, right? No, not for Ecclesiastes, because the people of the town forgot about the guy that saved their lives. So is Ecclesiastes just basically negative about everything? Kind of, but it's more complicated than that, because in the midst of all the darkness, the light begins to shine. Chapter 11:1 says, "Cast your bread upon the waters, for you will find it in many days." It's a proverb about not hoarding and about receiving back for generosity. All right, let's go, something positive. And more positive stuff follows. Verse 7 says, "Light is sweet and pleasant for the eyes to see the sun." And then, "So if a person lives many years, let him rejoice in all of them." And then he finishes with this, "But let him remember that the days of darkness will be many, and all that comes is vanity." And right there is the juxtaposition of Ecclesiastes. The things that you think will make you happy make you empty, but in that, there's hope of trust and remembrance of God. And when you look closer back at the book, there have been these little flashes of light in the midst of all the vanity poems. In chapter 2, There's more gain in light than in darkness. In chapter 3, God has put eternity into man's heart. In chapter 5, he says, "What I've seen to be good and fitting is to eat and drink and find enjoyment in all the toil." Chapter 9 says, "Go eat your bread with joy and drink your wine with a merry heart, for God's already approved what you do." Then the final chapter, it opens with my favorite verse in the book, "Remember now your Creator in the days of your youth." And it ends with, "Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God will bring every deed into judgment with every secret thing, whether good or evil." And just as mysteriously as it begins on a down note, the book of Ecclesiastes ends with a harmonious chord of vision. This book has been influential in ways we don't even see. There's a bunch of English idioms that originate here. "Eat, drink, and be merry" from chapter 8, "a fly in the ointment" from chapter 10, "for everything there's a season" from chapter 3, "from dust to dust," which has been said at hundreds of thousands of funerals, that's originally from here, from chapter 3. "There's nothing new under the sun" from chapter 1. You might be thinking, how does the book tie into the Bible though? Well, first of all, almost this entire book is man fell from the 7-part narrative of Scripture, but Jesus is here too, just in one verse. It's near the end and it's awesome. It's our Jesus moment for the book of Ecclesiastes. It says in chapter 12, verse 11, "The words of the wise are like goads." Goads are sharp devices that help cattle walk in the right direction. Then it says this, "And like nails firmly fixed are the collected sayings, they are given by one shepherd." It's very out of place in the book, like a lot of messianic moments in the Bible. This one's like walking through a forest and finding a golden cross hidden in plain sight. The Hebrew word shepherd there is only used 2 other times in the Old Testament, in Ezekiel in chapters 34 and 37, talking about the shepherd to come. He's called David in the passage, but David's already been dead for 400 years. It's not David, it's the 2 Samuel 7, David of the future, the king who won't fail, the shepherd who leaves the 99 to find the one. Hopefully you. The shepherd Jesus. Let's say our narrative pieces of Scripture together. God created, man fell, Jesus promised, Jesus fulfilled, Jesus followed, Jesus returning, and the Bible is God's word.